Okay, welcome everyone. Hopefully those who are here can hear me. I think there's a speaker behind Josh over here. And I'm using the mic also because it sounds like we've got 25 or 30 people online on Zoom. And usually that'll creep up as the few minutes before the talk starts. So welcome everybody to our first in-person event. It's great to have you here physically in our space. If you haven't been here before, this is the Ingenuity Labs Research Institute. Graduate research in the area of robotics and AI happening here in the space and across campus, but this is kind of the hub where we get together. So for those who are interested in that field, you know, make sure you stop by and meet some of the researchers and hopefully we'll see you, especially if you're an undergrad, maybe as you graduate, think about graduate studies in the field, and this is where you'd come at Queen's. How many people here managed to attend the symposium that we had? I know there's a few people. So we had a great symposium not that long ago. It was online, so it wasn't in person, but it was, you know, rather entertaining. I thought we had some debates and a really good speaker. I had somebody tell me afterwards that it was, you know, after a year of online conferences, it was the best one they'd attended. So that was nice to hear. But part of the highlight too was that we had some poster competitions. We had a student three-minute thesis competition as well. And so before we get started with our talk today, I wanted to just make a quick announcement about those winners because we have some prizes for them, and I know a few of them I think are here in the room. So the best robotics poster at our symposium went to Thomas Huckle. Is Thomas here? Yeah, oh, there he is, right. So Kate has something for you. So congratulations to Thomas. Pritam Sarkar was the best AI poster. There he is there. Okay, so round of applause for Pritam. Some honorable mentions to David Kalatian and Ryan Keeley, Austin Greitzman, and Satare Taganaki for posters that were also worth mentioning but didn't make the top. So congratulations to those people as well. We also had our thesis showcase competition. And is Bryony here? No, Bryony's not here. So Bryony Shauna Will, she was the winner of the three-minute thesis competition, so Kate will get her prize later. We also had Student Choice Award. This was voted by our guests from the Bay Ridge Secondary School group that came to our symposium. So these are high school students who are working in the Bay Ridge program. There's a computer science program there. So John Swain, the teacher there, sent a bunch of students, and they voted for Yunal Artan in the three-minute thesis competition. Is Yunal here? I didn't see Yunal come in. So he'll get... He's online. Okay, great. So, Yunal, congratulations. Everybody can give you a round of applause here. And, yeah, so there's a prize for you. And then I just wanted to shout out and thanks, and we've got some little gifts for the student organizers. Layla Kalegi, Jefferson Silvera, and Thomas Sears. Are any of them here in the room? I think they're all online, right? So they worked really hard to help put on that symposium. I can't tell you the number of hours that went on behind the scenes to make that happen for that one day. So thanks a lot to all those people, especially Kate and Ramsey as well, and some of the faculty, Zhao Dan Zhu, who participated to make that all happen. So thanks again. Big round of applause to them. Okay, now what you're really here to hear is not me talk about the symposium last week, but to hear about our new faculty member, Matt Pan, who's agreed to give us a chat today about his past research and what he's thinking about doing in the future here at Queen's. So Matt has his PhD from and his master's degree from UBC, where he worked, I think was with Elizabeth Croft in her lab, which is quite a well-known robotics lab in Canada. Has his undergraduate degree in mechatronics from University of Waterloo, but is joining us from Disney in Los Angeles, where he worked with the Imagineering group there. And a whole bunch of projects really in the HRA, so the Human-Robot Interaction space. So I'm not going to go into details about that because you're going to hear all about that from Matt. So please join me in giving Matt a very warm welcome. I see Ramsey has his hand up. So. Ah, right. So before I let Matt take the stage, for those who are online, if you have questions, Ramsey's manning the chat over there so he can... highlight questions that you might have, and we'll try to get them asked, I think, so that everybody can hear them. We may try to get you if you want to try to speak, but the chat is also useful. So if you have questions, and if you're in the audience here, of course, just put up your hand, and we will probably hand you the mic because then those who are online can hear you. All right, Pat, the floor is yours.
All right, can you guys, I have my my mic. This is a great turnout. Thanks for coming out, guys. This is awesome. This is my first live talk since the beginning of the pandemic. So I'm going to be speaking about creating remarkable human-machine interactions. But before I begin, I'd like to credit the academic influences in my life. So I actually studied under Elizabeth Croft and Karen McLean for my master's, both of whom were at UBC. Elizabeth has since moved on to become Dean of Engineering at Monash University in Australia. Karen is within the CS department at UBC. And then I also worked with Gunter Niemeyer, who's a control specialist at Disney Research in Los Angeles. And I can't say enough great things about these people. These people have inspired my passion for both robotics and human-robot interaction. So I would like to say that my work can be characterized by a desire to build cool robots. Now, obviously, this isn't a statement that I could put on a grant application. So more specifically, my projects sort of go into providing social and physical human-robot interaction or assistance to people to improve their quality of life. In essence, I really want to build robotics and interactions that feel remarkable and that people enjoy using. And I think this is important because I think having people enjoy their interactions is critical for the adoption of collaborative robotics in both homes and workplaces to improve quality of life. Now, when I'm saying I'm trying to achieve the remarkable, I don't actually mean that I'm conducting any really groundbreaking or earth-shattering research, which kind of feeds into my imposter syndrome. But the argument that I would like to make is what makes interactions feel remarkable and look remarkable is the result of marginal gains, where small improvements in the way that interactions are conducted can have profound effects on how people perceive and conduct and enjoy that interaction. So a theme of my work previously has been to build upon the work of experts who have done the legwork in machine learning, in human-robot interaction, in human understanding, and for me, that enables me to turn to look at subtleties of interaction, looking at things like aesthetics, behavior, kinematics, forces that people that enable people to really enjoy working with robots. So to demonstrate this, I'm going to take you back about 9 years or more to the start of my PhD. Where I examined human-robot handovers. So at the start of my PhD, I was involved with a collaborative research project with General Motors to figure out how human-robot assistance could be implemented on a factory floor to assist in manufacturing of vehicles and to reduce worker fatigue and worker repetitive strain injury. And during my time working on this project, I developed a fascination with how robots can conduct handovers to deliver tools and supplies and parts to workers on the floor. But at the time, handovers were clunky and pretty slow, as you can see here. So I made exploring human-robot handovers my central thesis topic, and in particular, how to enable them and how to make them better. So the one thing I really honed in on at the beginning of my studies is that really, if you think about it, nothing about handovers between people, for that sense, make any sense except when viewed in the light of nonverbal cues. So with handovers between people, we're able to conduct these interactions in the order of a few seconds, which is impressive. And the way that we're able to do that is through these nonverbal cues, such as how I'm handing over an object, my arm configurations I'm handing over, my body language, as well as the haptic or the sense of touch cues that are exhibited when handing over that object. And this allows us to basically hand over things blind and not be able to not drop them, which is amazing. So my PhD thesis was mainly predicated on the idea that if we study such nonverbal cues, that perhaps we can have robots produce and replicate some cues on these robotic systems to generate the same efficiencies that we see with human-human interactions or human-human handovers. So more formally put, we need to figure out how nonverbal cues during handover can influence how people perceive the interaction, how they conduct the interaction. So one of the first nonverbal cues that I looked at in my PhD research was in gaze. So I, along with a team of researchers, about 15, looked at how anthropomorphic robots could use gaze. So anthropomorphic is a term used very loosely here, where we just have a robot with a head. How they could use gaze to affect the fluency of the interaction, the perception of that, the social perceptions of that interaction, and the timing of that interaction. To preface this investigation, and we looked at handovers between humans and tried to tease out what sort of gaze profiles were being used by humans. And we found two. The first one is used by a majority of people when conducting handovers, which we call the shared attention gaze, where as a giver, as he or she is handing over an object, he or she is looking at the handover location where the handover is going to take place. Then we have something called a turn-taking gaze condition. I think this is cutting up, but that's okay. A turn-taking gaze condition, which where givers employ a shared attention gaze, but at the very end of that reach of handing over an object, they look up at the to the other person to signal, it's your turn, you can take the object now. So informed by this human-human study, we wanted to see if those same gaze profiles, when implemented on a robot, would have any effect on the timing and user perception of that interaction. So we conducted a fairly large study with 102 participants. And this study was kind of amazing in that we actually ran all 102 participants in a single day, which is almost unheard of. Okay, I think the battery may just be cutting out. So I... we ran. Oh, good. Okay. And people give a water bottle from the, keep the water as a token of our appreciation. We implemented three gaze profiles on the robot. The first gaze condition was what we call the no gaze condition, where the robot looked down the entire time. We also replicated the shared attention gaze condition, where the robot looks at the handover location during handover. And we had the turn-taking gaze condition, where the robot looks up at the end of a shared attention gaze. What we found in terms of subjective results is that people overwhelmingly found that the turn-taking condition was preferred. They liked it, even though we didn't tell them what conditions we were testing and even that we were testing gaze. So they didn't know any of this, but implicitly through the surveys of and ranking conditions, they told us that they enjoyed the turn-taking condition, and it was seen as more natural and better in terms of communication of timing. Now, looking at handover efficiency in terms of the time to completion of the handover, we find that shared attention because in the attention gaze, we're having the robot look at the handover location that's going to be happening in the future, this allows users to preemptively reach out even before the robot has completed their handover motion, to reach out for the object and complete the handover faster. So one of the main messages I was able to take away from this study was that the seemingly unimportant and overlooked cues such as gaze can have this significant of an impact on an interaction, then surely there must be other types of nonverbal cues that can have similar profound impacts on handovers as well as other human-robot interactions. So for interactions with robots, this sort of study primes my hypothesis that nonverbal cues can serve as little hints or idiosyncrasies that can assist the user in determining how to conduct that interaction so that they can complete it efficiently. So this type of work that I was doing with subtle cues and human-robot interaction really interested one organization, and that organization is Disney. Interest in creating character experiences with animatronic figures that would and mimic the nonverbal anthropomorphic behaviors for expressive context. I was interested in creating handover animatronics, which meant that they could be faster and smoother than what we've seen previously. In this vein, I developed a prototype system to kind of start exploring what handovers with robotic character might begin to look and feel like. So to create this character platform, my colleagues and I took a Kuka Iwa robot and made some slight cosmetic changes. And ta-da, we have a robot character. Now, this is something, with these simple changes, we were able to create less of a machine, but more of a character that you might want to get to know and get to want to interact with, or as an entity perhaps with personality. So we use this platform to help explore handing over objects with an anthropomorphic character and what that might look and feel like. So on this platform, I implemented a bidirectional handover system that's capable of emulating human speed, which we hadn't seen before in previous literature. So with the system, their question arose of, well, can generate handovers on human speeds. Is this something that people want and prefer? So in our studies on physical human-robot interaction, we found that the small sensor motor delays in the way that robots conduct handshaking interactions greatly improved people's perception of that interaction, made it feel more anthropomorphic and human-like. Additionally, in my own research, I found that people preferred to have fast handovers. This is, up to this point, as I said, all the handover sort of robotics was limited in speed, and we wanted to see whether or not people enjoyed having robots move at human speed, which hadn't been done previously. So in terms of a user study, we looked at the quickness of movement as two separate concepts. The first being reaction time or sensor motor delay, where we emulated no delay condition, which is essentially the fastest reaction time that the robot can have, which is based on the overall system latency. A short delay, which matches human delay on the order of 250 milliseconds, and a long delay condition at 750 milliseconds. So this is what that looks like. This is the long delay, again at 750 milliseconds. Short delay, which matches human reaction time, and no delay. And if you run that all together, you can see that there's marked differences in the time in which the robot reacts. So we also created three arm speed configuration, so how quick the robot moved its arm, slow, moderate, and fast. So the slow speed took about 2 seconds, the moderate speed took about 1.5 seconds, which is what we saw for human handovers, and then we had a fast speed, which is about 1 second. Now, to measure people's perceptions or social perceptions of the robot, we used a tool called the Robotic Social Attribute Scale, or ROSAS for short, which is essentially an in-house scale developed at Disney Research by my colleagues Colleen, Alyssa, Michael, and Steven. And it measures people's social perceptions to robots on three dimensions: competence, warmth, and discomfort. Now, it's interesting because in the behavioral sciences literature, when people are evaluating other people's perceptions of, or when people are evaluating their social perceptions of other people, only the dimensions of competence and warmth show up. The dimension of discomfort is purely something that applies to robotics, which is interesting. And this arose naturally from people's interactions for robots. And Colleen was able to validate that. So when looking at the results, in terms of arm speed, we don't really see anything too surprising, where the fastest speed induced significantly more discomfort compared to the slow arm speed. The interesting result comes from reaction time, where an interaction with small sensor-motor delays was rated as having more warmth compared to long delays. Additionally, we found that the no-delay condition induced more discomfort to participants compared to both the small and long delays. This seems to provide some indication that small delays on the order of human sensor-motor delays is preferred by people interacting with anthropomorphic robots. So we see that through a small cue, such as just delay and movement speed, that is able to affect people's perceptions of how that robot is socially perceived. And we also find that, aligned with our previous studies on handshaking interactions, that sensor motor delay on the order of human delay is preferable. And we're hoping to explore this concept for not only anthropomorphic robots, but robots of differing configurations, so industrial arms, for example. We're not sure whether we'll see the same preference, but I think that's an interesting research area. So, as any sort of Imagineer, Disney Imagineering knows, is that you have to prepare, you have to robustify your system, because everyone inside Disney parks, guests particularly, parents with children, when they hear the Disney name, they think, oh, this will let children roam around and play with anything they want, thinking that it's allowed and it's safe. That isn't true. Whenever we play tests, droids inside Disneyland Park, kids were climbing all over that droid, which is kind of scary as Imagineers, but we were able to prepare for those situations. And that's the same thing that I was trying to attempt with robustifying some of the interactions that we may see when guests try to use this system. And to sort of close out this section of work, I wanted to show that robustness can actually be a draw for participants. And this demonstrates the system with untrained participants.
Basically, reach out and the... might have to get just a little closer. There you go. It's going to hand it back and you can take it. Awesome. All right. We can have one more volunteer.
So with that, we move into a project that I had a lot of fun working on, and I think you might enjoy. And here's a video to demonstrate what that project is.
Thank you. All right, so at the start of my time with Disney, Parks and Resorts was just getting into the Star Wars intellectual property. In fact, at the time, they were starting to build the Galaxy's Edge lands in both Disneyland and Disney World. And the execs had this blue sky idea to try to include the iconic moment where Luke Skywalker or Rey uses the Force to grab a lightsaber. So for those of you not well-versed in Star Wars lore, the Force is essentially telekinesis, using the power of the mind to draw in objects. So at Disney Research, we were tasked with trying to figure out how to develop this sort of interaction for guests and how to prototype it. And it was fortuitous because 2016, Oculus had just come out with their Rift VR headset. And we have to have a few lying around, so we thought, well, this might be great because with VR, you actually hide the real world. So if we wanted something like a robot to deliver a lightsaber to someone, they won't see the robot. And hopefully with the VR visuals, you can actually time both the lightsaber that you see in VR and the lightsaber that you actually have in hand. You could time it correctly so those are matched and you would have this compelling interaction. So the problem was that at the time, VR was, VR has been around for a long time, but at the time there wasn't much exploration in the area of having flying objects come at you when you're immersed in VR because it's inherently a safety problem. But we thought that this experience might make this system or exploration of such a system worthwhile. And so because there wasn't any prior literature, we actually had to come up with the system ourselves. And we had to pay particular close attention to how spatial cues and timing matched in both the virtual and physical world. So in order to facilitate low latency systems, we used a real-time capable PC, which is essentially pretty much a regular PC with a real-time kernel of Linux embedded. And we were able to use this PC to sort of help timestamp and coordinate what the person is seeing in VR and also what they would be feeling through the robot. So the coordination of timing actually turned out to be the most significant challenge in this, and what we ended up having to do was measure end-to-end latency of the system so that we can account for this latency in both generating trajectories for the robot as well as delivering visuals through the Oculus Rift headset. So this is a video, actually, the next two videos are pretty cool because they represent what happened the first time we actually got the system running. And if you take anything away from the talk, it's this message that whenever you run experiments, always leave the camera running. So the first attempt was, well, underwhelming. And the reason for that was because the visual lightsaber in VR was actually a few milliseconds too early, and so the experience didn't feel real or compelling. So after tweaking some timing values, we get this. And on the left-hand side is what I saw in VR as I was experiencing this this particular demo. I apologize for my poor digital asset creation skills. So in that moment, a VR experience that you knew wasn't real turned into something completely magical in Disney Imagineering parlance. A single moment can make you believe that you actually wielded the power of the Force or had supernatural powers. And it's sort of this timing that sort of made this experience so powerful. Now, the interaction was so compelling that actually it eventually got put into an internal Disney show. And the story behind this is literally 30 seconds after we shot this video, the president of R&D walks by and he was wondering what we were doing with the VR headset and robot since we showed him. And he said, oh, you gotta show the Bobs this. And Bobs refers to Bob Weiss, who is the president of Imagineering, Bob Chapek, who's the president of Parks and Resorts, and Bob Iger, who's the CEO. So we put this into an internal show called Open House, which isn't actually open to the public. It's just for higher-level C-suite executives at the company. And the show was created to be modeled like a magic trick, where with the story being that a participant or a Jedi Padawan is training to use the Force through a Jedi Master. And there's a saying that goes that every great magic trick has three parts. The first part being the pledge, where the magician shows you something ordinary. And we did this training because we needed to establish context for the experience, namely where they were going to receive the object from the robot. We didn't tell them there was a robot. They got to feel the weight of the object and what the object is supposed to do. So in the real world, the guest can cause the lightsaber to shake a little bit in its box, but to their disappointment, it wouldn't fly out of the box and hit their hand. So the Jedi Master then suggests, well, I think you need to tune into the Force a little bit more, so we're going to put a blast shield over your eyes to block out external distractions, which is, some of you may know, is something from the first episode 4, A New Hope. So we found that we actually had to implement some sort of training because participants, when they were naive to what was going to happen, they held out their hand and the lightsaber literally came and it bounced out of the hand because they weren't expecting it. And that's why in the previous video that I showed, there was some, I don't know if you noticed, there's some tape. That's where the lightsaber broke because people had dropped it too many times because they weren't expecting the real object to actually hit their hand. So after the pledge, there is the turn, where the magician takes something ordinary and makes it extraordinary. And this is like the actual show. This is this was taken on stage with a naive participant. All right, and at the end, there's the prestige, where in this case, it's for us to hide the mechanism that made the object extraordinary. So the participant really never knew what happened on stage. A lot of people thought that someone just came up and handed them a lightsaber, but then they got confused because how did the timing work out so well? But through this illusion, we found that by adding dynamic content to a virtual interaction, it increased the level of immersivity to the point where people were saying after the show, oh, I felt so empowered, I felt like a superhero, I felt like I could do anything in that virtual world. So I'm pretty proud of the fact that over 250 people were able to try this demonstration, and we only had maybe 6 failures, basically where people, it's a little bit funny, that we didn't actually, this kind of feeds into equity, diversity, and inclusion, where the lightsaber, and I'm passing a lightsaber around, if, there we go, was actually too big for a lot of people's hands and just fell out. So there were some failures, but for the most part, most people caught it and they were amazed by this interaction. So Gunter and I sat down after on the heels of this project and we thought, well, this is really cool. We can do dynamic interactions in VR and that increases immersivity. What else can we do? And I think at the time, Gunter was practicing how to juggle. Thanks. Gunter was practicing, and he came up with the idea, well, in real life, training for juggling is actually a binary training task where you either catch the ball while you're juggling or you don't, okay? What if we can actually have the feeling of juggling in VR, where in VR you see that you're always catching the ball and in real life, you could be throwing balls all over the place. But you can eventually train yourself by using a dial on the difficulty in VR to eventually get to the point where you're actually juggling fairly quickly. And we wanted to test this sort of training hypothesis, but we came across a more fundamental problem. And that was, we didn't even know if you can catch a real ball while immersed in virtual reality. So that was sort of my next task. And what I did for this project was really take that Force grab VR demonstration, strip out all the visuals, remove the robot, remove the lightsaber, and literally just render a tennis ball that was being tracked by a mocap system. So on the first few attempts, the results were not great. And there was two reasons for this. Number one, there's visual distortion introduced by the virtual reality headset. So the lenses in the headset aren't perfect, and they can induce some sort of distortion in your visual field. There's also a very common problem of distance misestimation, where people immersed in VR misestimate distances. They tend to think that objects appear closer than what they actually are. The way that we solved this first problem was actually fairly simple. We just rendered hands in VR. We don't have to render fully functional hands, we just had to render abstract representation of hands. And just with that, and so you see that I'm wearing gloves, with that, your body's proprioceptive senses is able to coordinate with what you're seeing in VR and able to adapt to any distortions very, very quickly. The other issue, which was more difficult, was latency in the system. So latency of the system we measured was about 75 milliseconds, which made it difficult for me to put my hand at the catch point. But there's a really cool way, at least in my mind, that we got around this. And that is, in VR, you can render anything. And the trajectory of the ball is easily predictable because it's following ballistics, right? It's high school math. So what you can do is totally negate the effects of delay by forward rendering the ball to basically negate the effects of delay. And that's what we did. And what you get with that is, well, regular catching looks kind of normal and looks boring. Great. We can catch in VR. However, there's the advantage that in VR you could always render more stuff. So you can render the future trajectory of the ball, as well as, well, what if you take out the ball completely and the trajectory completely and just render a target? Now you've actually turned the person into a robot, where all they have to do, instead of needing to predict where the ball is going to be in the future, is just stick out a hand where the system tells you to, and the ball lands in their hand, which is actually quite fun. And you can do pretty neat tricks very easily like this. I'm trying to figure out how to capitalize on this or make it into some sort of live show. So if you have any ideas, yeah, please come tell me, because I think this is really cool. So after this, we actually patented this technology, and we called it hypercatching in virtual reality. Now, the reason why we call it hypercatching is, remember, we can render anything. So you're not restricted to rendering a ball. You can render Captain America's shield or Thor's hammer, where you throw it, it hits some bad guys in VR, comes back, and you're able to catch it, no problem. Additionally, you're not rendered to rendering in real time. You can actually render in bullet time, where the ball comes at you, it slows down, and then speeds up, and you're still able to catch it. You could have effects such as fireballs going in a spiral, still be able to catch. So there's a ton of things that you can do with this sort of technology, and it's not limited to just ball catching. We're still trying to, we didn't actually get to the juggling part as my internship sort of ran out, but I kind of want to still explore how to train dexterous manipulations through VR, such as juggling. And this technology actually gained some interest when it was published from people in the sports industry looking for sports training, which we were never able to work on. But one interesting idea was that we can use this for stroke rehabilitation. So when people obtain a stroke or have a stroke, they usually lose function in one side of their body. And they have reduced motor functionality, typically in their arms or legs. And so in physical therapy, stroke patients have to reproduce basically the same motions over and over again. What if we can have a real reward where they're able to catch a ball while participating in these exercises? That might motivate them more to complete their training. So this generated a lot of ideas, but unfortunately there wasn't a lot of time to do them. So I hope to sort of explore this concept here at Queen's and possibly at Ingenuity Lab. So if you guys have any ideas on how this technology can be used, I'd love to hear it. So this leads me to the last chapter of this presentation, which is on some recent work that I did right before I left Disney. And you may have seen it on the Stephen Colbert, I think it's called The Late Show with Stephen Colbert. But anyways, without further ado, here's the video.
We present a system for creating lifelike gaze interactions between people and an animatronic character. Our architecture implements mutual gazing behavior, demonstrating the illusion of life. We use a subsumption architecture to allow us to layer simple motor movements such as breathing, blinking, and saccades to create increasingly complex and lifelike behaviors. Additionally, we use mechanisms that mimic human motor and attention behaviors. The overall result is an interactive human automatronic experience that engages people through animated realism. For more information, please visit la.disneyresearch.com.
So, in Disney resorts and parks, there's literally hundreds of audio animatronic characters. Only a handful of those are interactive. For example, Mr. Potato Head in the top left. And actually, none of those interactive animatronics are humanoid. And the reason for this, as you may have noticed, that is it can induce some feelings where it feels like you're stepping into the uncanny valley. It's very, very difficult to produce interactivity that doesn't feel creepy or awkward. So really, this project that we embarked on was a first attempt at trying to create interactivity for a humanoid anthropomorphic audio animatronic figure. And to give us the greatest chance of success, we looked at a behavior that we thought could give us the greatest impact just through marginal gains, and that was gaze. And the huge question in the back of our minds was, we aren't designing this system to be used by engineers. We're designing the system to be used by animators. So at Disney, there are animators whose job is literally to handcraft animations for robots. It's a huge, huge field, and a lot of people work in that area. And they're essentially artists. So in that regard, I would say that our approach to building this type of interactive system had to be from an animation perspective rather than biological. And for that approach, we turned to sort of the quintessential handbook in animation, in screen animation, that is The Illusion of Life by Thomas and Johnston. And if you approach any sort of animation specialist, they will probably have this book on their shelf because it was so influential in the way animation is created on screen. So one such animation principle that we utilized was the concept of anticipation, where movements sort of allow people to anticipate what that character or that object is going to do next. Another concept was the principle of overlapping action and follow through, where different parts of the body move at different rates. And if you think about this in terms of a physical body, that makes sense because different parts of your body have different inertias. So in terms of the mutual gaze action, the movement of a gaze or a gaze profile is always led with the eyes first, then with the head, and if the robot had a torso, the torso follows, giving this really natural fluid motion of establishing gaze or mutual gaze with another person. So as engineers, we kind of think of these terms as both like servo wing frequency and overshoot. You always kind of want to have overshoot of movement. So the architecture that we built for this system is fairly simple, actually. We had a camera, as you saw, that was mounted on the chest of that robot. And that camera fed an RGBD data to a perception engine, which generated skeletons of people in the robot's environment. So it would basically measure people's kinematics with respect to the robot from an egocentric point of view. So that perception engine fed skeleton data into what we call the attention engine, which is essentially a formula. And that formula represents how salient a person is in the robot's environment. So if I'm waving both my hands, running up to the robot, that will generate a greater curiosity score compared to someone who's just sitting down and doing nothing. So we feed that curiosity score into what we call the behavior selection engine, which is essentially a state machine. And there's four states on the robot: reading, where the robot pretends to read; glancing, where the robot attends to salient but not very critical stimuli in its environment. So just a short glance up and then back to reading. We have engagement where if you rush up at the robot, try to get the robot's attention, it will look up and give you a dead stare and stare you down. It's kind of funny. And then we also have acknowledgement, where people that it had recognized previously, so for example, I interacted with the robot a lot, so it recognized me, it would look at me, and then it would acknowledge me, using sort of like a small head nod. And the behavior selection engine, we're able to select behaviors from what we call the behavior library, which is, like its name, just a collection of small behaviors that could be layered on top of each other. And this sort of borrows from the concept of a subsumption architecture, which was developed by a guy named Rodney Brooks, who's a professor at MIT. He's famous for a lot of robotics research and co-founding iRobot, which is the company that makes the robot vacuum cleaners. So he came up with the subsumption architecture, which is a hierarchical approach to generating complex behaviors in robots, where higher levels of behavior could subsume, control, inhibit, or even enhance lower level behaviors. And initially he used the system on mobile robots, but this system, this type of architecture really lends itself well to human behaviors, because if you think about it, in ourselves, we at the lowest level have very low level behaviors, such as breathing, blinking, your heart rate, that are involuntarily controlled, saccades even. And at the higher level, you have behavioral responses such as fight or flight, where the fight or flight response can induce faster heart rate, can create your breathing to go faster. And it's sort of this bottom-up approach that really lends itself well to human anthropomorphic behaviors and generating complexity. And so even though we weren't aiming towards a biologically inspired system, we ended up generating something that was subtly biological. So the combination of these systems really seems to provide a compelling experience for our guests. And it's through the work of Rodney Brooks and Imagineers at Disney that I was able to really build upon that work that they conducted and focus on the subtleties that make gaze feel real and lifelike. So this brings me back to my main point of this talk, is that by leveraging existing technologies, essentially I've been afforded the ability to focus on small, subtle, nonverbal cues that can make or break interactions. And these interactions become something more than the sum of the marginal gains, and become something compelling and enjoyed by people. So sort of to conclude my talk, my work has been based on the belief that interactions that people enjoy and are perceived to be compelling are major motivators for the adoption of such collaborative technologies in our homes and workplaces. And I hope that I've shown that just by the application of some subtle cues that and careful changes to the way that robots conduct interactions, we can create machines that can become remarkable. And before I end my talk, I was instructed that I should give a little bit of a spiel on why I want to join Ingenuity Labs as a colleague, and really I'll boil it down to three reasons. Number one, interdisciplinary collaboration. I've looked through the bios of everyone in Ingenuity Labs, and I think your work is amazing, and I really want to collaborate with you on projects. I think there is an aligned vision between my research and the research at Ingenuity Labs, in particular trying to get robotics and AI to improve the quality of life of people and their efficiency, as well as productivity and safety. And I also want to create remarkable robot interactions with Ingenuity Labs, and I think this is a great environment to explore these type of interesting research problems. So with that, I'll thank you for coming out to my talk. I hope you've enjoyed it and had fun with it. And I guess that's it. I guess we'll open up the floor to questions.
Maybe you want to do it. I don't know. You have the mic now. So, but questions from the floor. And I know there's some. Are there questions in the chat, Ramsey? So any from the floor first? Okay, I'm going to run back over. Oh, we only have one mic, though. So.
Is this working? Yeah.
Hi, Matt.
First of all, thank you. That was absolutely fascinating talk. I think every robotics talk should have some video clip of science fiction in it, so I fully appreciate that. So my only question, well, I had a bunch of questions I'm sure we'll talk after, but the thing that popped out to me was at the beginning when you were talking about the handoffs. There was a sort of a built-in assumption of practicality and some idea that the robot was even tempered and was expected to collaborate and be cooperative. But was there any thought given to how you could actually use those parameters you mentioned, which affect the comfortability or the relationship that people feel to the robot, exploit those in some way to actually tune the expectation? So if you actually want the robot to appear angry or upset or sluggish or lethargic, could you actually, I'm sure this has crossed some of your minds, but I'm curious what the progress or the development of that is in using those things.
That is,
can you guys hear me through the mic? Great, let me move this up. That is actually a great question. Actually, this is some work that we were looking at Disney, because generating emotive content through physical interactions is really a selling point for what you see in the, what Imagineers want to see in the parks. So, right before actually talking with, suggesting that one concept is a multiple role. You drink, you sort of empathize with a person if they're talking to you regarding their feelings or whatever, and they're able supposed to do some crowd control as well. So they have multiple roles that require multiple different types of gestures and nonverbal cues to demonstrate emotive content. And it's something that I want to explore, and I totally, that's one of the things that I'll promise I'll do if I get to join Ingenuity Labs, is to build a bartending bot that is able to emote different sort of character interactions and leverage nonverbal cues for generating angry behaviors or stern behaviors or happy behaviors. So I think that's a very interesting research topic, and I'd love to talk to you more about that.
Yeah, there's one online here. So this is a question from Jefferson. When you were doing the saber manipulation trick, how did you deal with the possible safety issues, like some singularity causing the manipulator to suddenly hit the user?
There was actually several safety Disney implements. There are literally multiple levels of safety. One of the levels of safety, the most basic one, is that if you've noticed in one of the videos, the first video I showed, the user or the participant was standing inside of a marked area that was delineated by a small edge, and they weren't supposed to step out of that edge. And the reason for that is because the body of that person will never, if they're standing inside that box, will never intersect the workspace of the robot, only the arm will. So if anything, if there's happened to be a collision, it would just be with the arm. So there was never really any chance of severe injury. Now, there's also other safeguards. For example, the VR headset was tracked, which meant that the head or pretty much anything besides the hands entered the workspace of the robot, there was an e-stop immediately engaged automatically. Additionally, there was at any time five people that all had e-stops. So I had an e-stop. There's two people in the back that had an e-stop. Gunter had a wireless e-stop. So there was literally multiple levels of safety, so no one ever got injured, which I'm happy to say, on the force grab set. Thank you for that, Jefferson.
That last robot with the gaze. So can you tell us why the robot doesn't have any skin? Because, you know, the more I thought about it, the more experience is really great.
show that. It's not well known, but skins are incredibly expensive. To make a skin can cost upwards of close to $100,000 US. Because it's a lot of artistry, there's a lot of mold making, there's a lot of testing and repairs that has to be done to skins. So any of the skins that you see in the Disneyland resorts, they probably have been repaired several times using silicone. Essentially, the most prominent places where skins actually get damaged is at the corner of the lips and the eyes. Mostly lips if you have multiple jaw motions in a show. So yes, number one, they're expensive. Number two, the official reason why is because we didn't have a skin. We thought, we kind of, in the paper, gave an explanation that we wanted to show the complexity of Disney animatronics. So just to reduce the chance of that, in our publication, we just took off the skin. Now, there's an unofficial response that I will need to confirm or not when people mention it. And it's that we did have a skin. The skin was for is a replica of a very prominent US politician that was recently voted out. And it may have been more scary than not having a skin. So, those, anyways, don't spread that. But that's those are the possible four reasons why we didn't have skin.
Matt, can you go back to one previous question? Accidents, lightning stops. How many times have you engaged the e-stop?
We actually had to engage the e-stop twice. And the reason why was because had the light go into their hand, literally on the ground. But luckily the system automatically e-stopped, but we had also all pressed e-stop. So that was one case. Another case was that there was a network failure. So because you have so many computers, they're all networked together, someone had attempted inadvertently to do a denial of service attack. Accidentally, someone had run a Raspberry Pi that just kept spitting out messages to the network. And that caused the robot to sort of, it didn't, it just stopped, but then we just pressed the e-stop in that case. So those are the only two. No one was in any danger in any of those cases, which was great, but hopefully that answers your question. Oh, okay.
We're gonna wrap it up unless there are any questions in the audience. Something I didn't mention at the beginning of the talk was that this is also an IEEE-sponsored talk. And so on behalf of Ingenuity Labs, of course, we thank Matt Pan, but I'm going to invite Kayvon Histrodizad to come up on behalf of IEEE to present our speaker with a small token of appreciation. So Kayvon, I will give you the mic.
All right. Thank you very much. As Josh mentioned, this event has also been co-sponsored by Robotics and Automation Chapter of IEEE Kingston Section. And I want to thank Matt for insightful, inspiring talk, and I'm sure that it's going to initiate quite a number of collaborations in Ingenuity Lab. I appreciate that. I have a little token of appreciation from IEEE. I would like to present that to you.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Round of applause, please. Thank you. Thank you. All right.
Thank
yeah,
you so
you're welcome. You're welcome. Thank you.
That's it. Thanks for coming out.
Thank you so much, guys.